And there's great care in IMF programs to support those policies that enhance growth. Now, a fiscal consolidation strategy and a process to improve the public finances of a country, as the governor said, has to be a multiple-year program that addresses the key pressure points both on the revenue side and on the expenditure side. If the need is to reduce the deficit because the debt is very high, and high debts are very bad for economies because they're detrimental to growth and they generate a weakening of confidence in that country's economic policies. The only way to reduce the weight of public debt is by lowering the deficit and taking the policies that expand the economy so that the weight of the debt reduces over time. And that is what we have been trying to support in Jamaica through a standby arrangement that was approved last year. And the key issues there are to design a wage-setting mechanism that will give clarity on how much wages will be in the years to come and ensure that the evolution of the wage ratio in relation to the size of the economy falls in the next few years in line with the fiscal responsibility framework that the government has in place.
Just a quick follow-up, Mr. Baruah. You mentioned the wage issue. On page 36 of the Regional Economic Outlook, the IMF mentioned in Jamaica the paying of the 7% wage increase, but yet did not link this to future wage negotiations, which is a sticking point for the IMF and the government of Jamaica right now, because the increase in the wage, the 7% increase, represents a 2% real increase in GDP spending for the government. But yet still the government has not shown the IMF where the concomitant revenues will come from to match that increase in expenditure. Is the IMF at all worried that the medium-term target to get the wage levels down to 9% of GDP will be derailed by this payment of the 7% and no revenues being seen to match that payment? And is that the sticking point now surrounding the stalling, the reviews for three quarters, and another quarter just finished last week, 2 weeks ago, which should be reviewed?
What we are discussing with the authorities at this time, and have been for the last few months, is on the policy mix that will allow the program objectives related to the public debt and the wage bill to be met in a medium-term perspective. And one key issue of that discussion is wage policy, or I should say staffing costs, because it includes wages and pensions. Now, to the extent that we have yet to reach an understanding on exactly what specific policies will be adopted to ensure that the wage bill falls over time, then the reviews have yet to be completed, because this is an issue that is ongoing. And I can assure you that we have had intense conversations and continue to have with the authorities on finding the right balance. On the one hand, to give the credibility that a fiscal consolidation plan requires to have a positive impact on the economy, to promote private investment, to promote growth. Credibility is key, and that requires agreed targets over time and the policies that will get you to those targets over that period of time. The target of 9% is not an IMF target. That is the target of the Jamaican political leaders. As you know, this is enshrined in the legislation of Jamaica in the fiscal responsibility framework. So we are, both the authorities and the IMF are using that mandate as an anchor, and there has been no discussions about changing that anytime soon.
Thank you. Next question.
Ryan Jones, Startup Network. We in Barbados over the last day or two had our own economic review for the first 9 months of 2011. And one of the questions that came out, and
can you speak a little louder?
Into the mic.
One of the questions that came out of our review over the last 2 days has been the slow pace. We were expecting a 2% increase. It was just about 1%. And the question was, given all the factors of what have been going on in the international environment, if we were heading for a second, the double dip recession, we were assured by the governor that that wasn't the case. We don't see that being a ways off, so to speak. When you look at what is contained in the outlook for the region and how everything has been going with the international markets, the Eurozone especially, should we be concerned as a region about our economies just dipping again?
I'll take this one. For the whole 2 hours this morning, essentially we've been talking about exactly that, the fact that the downside risk to the global outlook is they're much higher now than they were 6 months ago. And if you recall, there was a slide in the presentation, and it's in the publication also, that shows, for example, that the increase in growth for Barbados for 2011 was going to be around, at the time we thought it would be around 1.8%. We concur with the governor's outlook for growth this year that it'll be around 1%. It may be slightly less, it may be slightly higher, but around 1%. And possibly for next year, we're looking at a more conservative projection for growth. Everything we heard this morning, the crisis in Europe, the continuing slowdown in the U.S. political system in terms of coming to some conclusion over the Jobs Act, for example, all of those are going to weigh very heavily on prospects for this region. We mentioned tourism as a big driver for this region. Barbados, this is one of your main economic activities, so I think at this point, we would say that the outlook will continue to be weak.
Go here, gentleman from Guyana, and then on the second row. We'll get back to you, don't worry.
Chamilal Naipaul, Guyana Chronicle. What's the IMF's view on what is being done by regional governments to stimulate investments, particularly foreign direct investments? And secondly, what's the IMF's view on bureaucracy and red tape within the governmental systems of this region?
Thank you for the question. Improving the investment conditions is a significant opportunity for the region. We were listening to representatives of the private sector this morning describe how the region would benefit from FDI, probably from newer regions of the world like Asia that are economically very buoyant. And Mr. Vergara made reference in his presentation to some comparative indicators on the ease of doing business, the cost of generating economic activity in various countries, and there are studies done by a number of organizations, including the World Bank, that show a diverse situation in the region, but in most countries, if not all of them, there is ample opportunity to improve in these areas, which could have very positive impact on investment and growth, at a time when the public sectors tend to have less space to maneuver because the crisis has affected their revenues, because the level of debt tends to be high in many countries. So certainly improving the investment climate is an opportunity that we hope will be seized by the countries in the region to offset some of this headwinds to growth that are coming from the international economy. I think it depends on the country thinking about. Your own country, Guyana, has very different challenges. It's in a particular policy path that is quite different to Jamaica or Barbados. And I think one has to take a look at the specific circumstances. Some of the issues that are quite important in attracting foreign investment are the ease to open a company. Mr. Vergara was referring to his experience when he was a policymaker in Spain. There are many institutions that get involved in the opening of the business, general government, local government, regulatory agencies, issues related to labor markets, how flexible are labor markets in hiring and downsizing that tend to have an important consideration, issues of the cost of paying taxes. Some countries are very good in making it easy for taxpayers to fulfill their obligations. Others are not. Taxpayers pay in many agencies, and it takes a lot. So the World Bank, for instance, publishes an annual report, doing business report, that they look at these critical